Yeah, so on the sell side, and this is typically consistent of media owners or potentially retailers or a party who has ownership of a rich data asset that they don't necessarily want to be shipping out into the ecosystem. This is what we typically think of as the sell side of the clean room kind of two-sided marketplace. When it comes to the sell side, a lot of the use cases that we're seeing today are really around audience creation. So enabling new combinations of audiences to be used for campaign activation across media properties. Insights, so enabling advertisers to learn more about their consumers' interests and propensities by overlapping between what they kind of understand of their customers and also what they can learn from their partners. And also measurement, so incredibly important, has been for a long time, but I feel like this year in particular, knowing what's working from a performance perspective and being able to optimize campaigns, incredibly, incredibly important. So on the sell side, we have seen a tremendous amount of growth and in adoption of clean rooms across many of the major media owners. And what we're starting to see now is a kind of step two in that evolution in terms of how can we now kind of package and make it easy for advertisers who may be newer to the space to get started. And we're seeing a lot of things like the design of Kickstarter packages and things to help take that first day step and see an easy path to value with the sell side clean room programs.
Well, that's really interesting. So I'd like to flip the script and ask you a bit about what's happening with brands and media buyers. What can you tell us about the buy side and data clean rooms?
Absolutely. And there has been a lot of discussion around this. As we have seen that growth in adoption of data owners in leveraging clean rooms as like their safe and controlled way of collaborating with advertisers, the flip side of that is suddenly some advertisers are realizing that they've got, you know, 5, maybe 10 of these clean room relationships. And so starting to think about, well, how do I develop intelligence across the board if I've got multiple of these close direct relationships across what might be seen as walled garden style relationships? How do you then start to learn about what's working holistically across those environments? And also just from a pure orchestration perspective, how do you manage across those environments in a consistent way? So that's what we're starting to see, and what we at Habu are helping a lot of our brand customers with today, is how do you manage your clean room program in a holistic way so that you don't feel like you have many of these discrete relationships, but you have everything working together well in your ecosystem.
And finally, Alice, is there anything when you're looking ahead in the next 6 months to a year that you're really excited about or you expect to see or you'd like to see in this space?
Yeah, absolutely. So one of the things that is starting to emerge now, and I'm hoping to see a lot more of, is around parties when they're coming together to collaborate, actually coming together with joint learning agendas. This sounds really unsexy, but I think historically when working, particularly with first party data, a lot of companies have been very kind of guarded around their asset and what they have and what's the unique value of it. But as we're moving into this more kind of collaboration based economy, I think sitting down with your partners and having just an open conversation around like, what do you want to learn from my data and what can I learn about your data, just helps accelerate that path to value versus everyone kind of scurrying away into their internal groups and trying to figure out what they can get. I think coming together and having that open dialogue and actually the creation of a learning agenda together is incredibly powerful, and I think it has the potential to shape the way the companies are working together in future for mutual benefit of both.